Good afternoon and welcome to the stated meeting of November 22nd, 2022. I'm Majority Leader Keith Powers. I'd like to thank everyone for joining us here today. If you'd like to follow along, the agenda for today's meeting is posted on the City Council website.
Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Roll call.
Abreu.
Present.
Ariola.
Here.
Aviles.
Presente.
Ayala.
Here.
Barron.
Here.
Botcher.
Here.
Brannon.
Here.
Brewer.
Here.
Brooks Powers.
Here.
Caban.
Present.
Carr. De La Rosa.
Here.
Dinowitz.
Here.
Fadias.
Present.
Felice.
Here.
Gennaro.
Here.
Gutierrez.
Presente.
Hanif.
Here.
Hanks.
Here.
Holden.
Here.
Hudson.
Present.
Joseph.
Present.
Kagan.
Here.
Krishnan.
Here.
Lee.
Here.
Lewis.
Present.
Marte. Mealy.
Present.
Menon.
Here.
Moya.
Here.
Narcisse.
Présent.
Nurse. Jose.
Here.
Palladino.
Here.
Wrestler.
Here.
Richardson Jordan.
Present.
Riley.
Present.
Rivera.
Present.
Salamanca. Sanchez. Shulman.
Here.
Stevens.
Apologies, Sanchez present.
Thank you, Councilmember.
Here.
Thank you, Councilmember. Ung. Velasquez.
Present.
Vernikoff.
Here.
Carr. Here. Williams. Juan.
Present.
Jaeger.
Here.
Borelli. Powers.
I'm here.
Speaker Adams.
I am also here.
I'm glad to know we're all here. Thank you. We'll now have today's invocation, which will be delivered by Rabbi David Niederman of the United Jewish Organization of Williamsburg in North Brooklyn, located at 32 Penn Street in Brooklyn.
Madam Speaker and honorable members of the City Council, your work is so important and very much appreciated. May Hashem the Almighty shine His light on all of you in this chamber who represent all New Yorkers to succeed and in all your endeavors. At the end of this week, we'll be entering the Jewish month of Kislev, in which we celebrate Hanukkah when the Maccabees prevailed over the Greeks. It is also a month when we celebrate the rescue from Bergen-Belsen, Germany, of the Grand Rabbi Joel Teitelbaum of Satmar of blessed memory, who was central to the rebirth of the Orthodox Jewish community in New York after losing 6 million Jews by the Nazis. Sadly, however, 3 years ago, the month of Kislev, brought horrific, horrific tragedy to the Jewish community in New York and New Jersey. On December 10, 2019, gunmen entered the Hasidic Jersey City kosher supermarket and opened fire. At the end of the rampage, four beautiful, innocent people were killed, including a young Williamsburg resident who volunteered to the UJO, Moshe Katz. During that month, a machete-wielding man entered the rabbi's house in Muncie, attacked and injured many people, and sadly, one of them died. This past weekend, we are reminded again of the threat of hate-driven violence against the Jewish community. Friday night, law enforcement learned of imminent danger by two armed anti-Semites. Thanks to the vigilance and diligent action by the NYPD, the FBI, the MTA agents, they were intercepted at Penn Station on their way to kill people in the synagogue at Saturday night services. We are grateful to the mayor, the governor, and law enforcement agencies for being vigilant and proactive to protect the Jewish community. I specifically would want to thank the City Council and the Honorable Speaker Adams for funding initiatives and promoting policies against hate to protect all of our people. Your work is so important and so much appreciated. Thus, we pray to Hashem to bestow his blessing on the Speaker of the Council and upon all of its members, that you shall continue to use your energies to spread kindness, to keep our family safe, all of our communities secure, and to help all New Yorkers succeed in rise. So help us, Hashem. Amen.
Thank you, Rabbi Nydeman. Thank you for being with us today. I'm going to now ask Councilmember Lincoln Ressler to spread the invocation on the record.
Thank you, Majority Leader. I would like to thank the distinguished Rabbi David Nydeman for being with us today. For 33 years, the great Rabbi David Nydeman has been in charge of UJO Williamsburg and North Brooklyn. There is no more noble, no more compassionate, no more altruistic community leader in District 33. Rabbi Nydeman and his tremendous team, notably Sam Stern and David Katz, who are with us today, do a phenomenal job providing critical services and addressing the needs of the most vulnerable in our community. Together, we are fighting back against anti-Semitism and hate in all its forms. I feel profoundly fortunate to be Rabbi Niederman's partner and representative. I make a motion for unanimous consent to spread the invocation in full upon the record. Thank you, Rabbi Nydeman.
Thank you, Councilmember Ressler. We'll now have adoption of minutes by Councilmember Amanda Farias.
I make a motion that the minutes of the stated meeting of October 27th, 2022 be adopted as printed.
Thank you. We'll go to messages and papers from the mayor.
M's 101 and 102, Public Design Commission appointments.
Rules, privileges, and elections.
Communication from City, County, and Borough Offices.
M103, New York City Comptroller Annual Report.
Received, ordered, printed, and filed.
Petitions and communications.
None.
Land use call-ups.
None.
Thank you. We'll now have communication from Speaker Adrian Adams.
Thank you, Majority Leader, and good afternoon to everyone. I'd like to start by thanking our rabbi for the blessing today. And I'd like to thank all New Yorkers who voted in this past election. Congratulations to Governor Kathy Hochul for being the first woman elected to lead the state of New York. I look forward to continuing to work with her and Lieutenant Governor Antonio Delgado to advance our city and state. I also want to congratulate our own Senator Chuck Schumer for retaining his position as Senate Majority Leader. His outstanding leadership will continue to benefit not just our city, but the entire nation. Lastly, I want to thank Speaker Nancy Pelosi for her decades of leadership in the House of Representatives. Speaker Pelosi shattered glass ceilings and demonstrating what women's leadership can achieve for our country. We are grateful for her many years of dedicated public service as a legislative leader, and we are better for it. Today, I want to start by discussing the important work and achievement of this council to advance affordable housing as our city confronts a dire housing crisis. We have too few homes for New Yorkers, and that is felt the most by those who need affordable housing at the deepest levels. The affordable housing units we need the most are the least available. The New York City Housing and Vacancy Survey placed the vacancy rate for the lowest income apartments at less than 1%. The overall lack of housing is increasing housing costs and pressures on New Yorkers. We need hundreds of thousands more apartments with a focus on affordable units. The lack of affordable permanent housing is the underlying driver of our city's current level of homelessness, which rivals the Great Depression with over 60,000 New Yorkers left unhoused. We know this is likely an undercount and that this crisis disproportionately harms Black and Latino New Yorkers. The council has an important role to play in helping to advance the development of affordable housing. And we've been contributing our part to advance these efforts by approving major housing development projects in our land use process. Yesterday, the council's land use committee voted to approve 4 land use applications in Brooklyn and Queens that will collectively produce nearly 6,000 new units of housing, 65% of which will be affordable. Over 2,000 of the housing units, 30%, would be deeply affordable for extremely or very low-income households. These approved projects are the types of major steps we need to take to address the housing crisis. Today, we will vote on the 2 largest projects, Innovation Queens and Innovative Urban Village. They are different in character, not only because of their distinct locations, but the details of financing, land use, and development teams. Yet they share a common feature. They push aggressive affordable housing development forward by demanding more of the administration and private developers by working with this council to advance affordable housing at deep levels. With Innovation Queens, this council prioritized the greatest housing needs of the city and community by prioritizing a deepening of affordability. With the land use and policy experts on our staff, we put forward an innovative approach to use City FEPS vouchers to increase affordability and address the challenges New Yorkers have faced in utilizing them to secure permanent housing. We pushed for the administration to work towards this and the developer to set aside market rates for New Yorkers with these rental housing vouchers. This is major, not only for this project and the local community, but from a citywide policy perspective. Innovative Village is a pivotal project in East New York by longtime neighborhood stakeholder Christian Cultural Center. It would create nearly 2,000 affordable housing units, 200 for senior housing and 100 homeownership opportunities. Over 1,100 rental units, or 60%, would be reserved for extremely or very low-income households, and the remaining 750 rental units would be set aside for low-income residents. 100 homeownership opportunities would be reserved for moderate-income households. The development would provide a range of additional community benefits, including a 24-hour, 7-days-a-week daycare, a cyber cafe, workforce training center, a fresh food grocery store, a performing arts center, publicly accessible open space, shuttle service to subway stations, and resilient and sustainable features. Yesterday was a prime example of this body's leadership on housing. Members understand the scale of this housing crisis because our communities are facing it. We hear about their housing challenges in our communities day in and day out. This council is on the cusp of approving over 40 land use applications since January 2022, creating over 12,000 total housing units, with over 63% of them designated as affordable, to provide nearly 8,000 affordable apartments for New Yorkers. This is the type of bold action that our city needs to address this crisis. And I'm proud that we're stepping up to meet the moment. We must continue to lead, and I'm confident that this body will play a major part in the effort to address New Yorkers' housing needs. I'll have more to say on housing issues facing New York City in the coming weeks, but today, I'm proud of this body and the work our members and staff have done to understand the gravity of our challenge and are willing to confront it. I thank the council members who represent the districts where the land use applications we are approving today are located, as well as the members who have similarly advanced such projects throughout this year to develop more affordable housing. There are also partners in government who have played important roles in working with us, and I want to thank them as well. And finally, I want to make sure to thank the staff of our Council Land Use Division who provide members with the expertise and guidance to make this work happen. Paris Strotter, Chelsea Kelly, Brian Paul, Arthur Huh, Angelina Martez Rubio, James Catone, Ryan Cote, Tim Anderson, Julia Ehrman, Andrew Lassiter, Caitlin Greer, Sandy Nicholas, Maria Salbavaro, and Bridget James. Thank you all so much for your tireless efforts and expertise. In helping this council advance projects that deliver housing for thousands of New Yorkers and meet the needs of communities by supporting our ability to negotiate for our constituents. And before I continue, I want to take a moment also to acknowledge the loss of 7 New Yorkers who died while on the job over the past month. We are so very saddened by each of their deaths, and we send our condolences to their families and loved ones during this difficult time. 2 days ago, we observed Trans Day of Remembrance, which honors those whom we've lost to anti-trans violence. It also marks the end of Trans Awareness Week, during which we highlight the visibility, experiences, and ongoing challenges facing trans communities. It is so important that we continue to recognize this week because in states across the country, government officials are taking actions that would actually harm trans people. Earlier this month, 2 Florida medical boards approved new rules that restrict children from receiving gender-affirming care to treat gender dysphoria. Other states have similarly turned to medical boards to limit or restrict access to gender-affirming care. This is egregious and wrong, and it will lead to people losing their lives. In this city, we remain focused on supporting and uplifting all LGBTQIA+ New Yorkers, and we will continue to prioritize their health, safety, and well-being. On December 1st, we will observe World AIDS Day, during which we reaffirm our steadfast commitment to support people living with HIV/AIDS and remember those we've lost to AIDS-related illnesses. Established in 1988, World AIDS Day serves as an important reminder about the importance of our united mission to eradicate HIV/AIDS. The fight is not yet over, but as a city, we will continue to stand strong in support of all people living with HIV/AIDS. Coming up on November 28th, is Albanian Independence Day. And last night, the council hosted a celebration of Albanian culture, heritage, and history right here in the council chambers. It was a wonderful event highlighted the rich traditions of our Albanian communities. And I want to thank council members Carr, Felice, Holden, and Velasquez for helping to make it a very special evening. Thank you, council members. And as we celebrate Thanksgiving, in the next few days, I hope everyone has a happy and safe holiday spent with your loved ones. I'm thankful for all of you, and the hard work that you and your teams, your staff, your incredible staff have done to serve the people of this city. Don't forget to shop small on Small Business Saturday and donate to your favorite charities on Giving Tuesday. And finally, please join me in wishing a happy belated birthday to council members Kevin Riley and Keith Powers, whose birthday was on the 16th. And a happy birthday to council member Eric Dinowitz, who celebrated his birthday yesterday. I hope you all had a really good time celebrating with your families. Now let's move on to our stated agenda. Today we're voting on several legislative finance and land use items. We'll be voting on the following finance items. Introduction 798, sponsored by Council Members Justin Brannon, Farrah Lewis, Kristen Richardson-Jordan, and Diana Ayala by request of the mayor. We'll authorize an increase in the amount to be expended annually in the 125th Street and Dumbo Business Improvement Districts. A pre-considered resolution, sponsored by Council Member Justin Brannon, authorizes an Article 11 tax exemption for 12 buildings with a total of 251 residential units in South Williamsburg. And lastly, a transparency resolution approving new designations and changes of certain organizations receiving funding in the expense budget. We will be voting on the following land use items. The SCA site selection of a 252-seat early childhood center in Councilmember Hank's district. 78-18 164th Street rezoning, an application that will bring an existing non-conforming medical laboratory into conformance with zoning. The council will modify the boundary of the proposed C2-3 overlay by limiting it to the 164th Street frontage in Councilmember Gennaro's district. Innovative Urban Village will facilitate development of 11 new mixed-use buildings with 1,975 affordable residential units, ground floor commercial area, a performing arts center, residential and public parking, and open space surrounding the existing Christian Cultural Center House of Worship in Councilmember Barron's district. Innovation Queens, applications to facilitate development of a large-scale mixed-use development with over 3,100 housing units in 13 buildings ranging in height from 8 to 27 stories and over 2 acres of publicly accessible open space in Councilmember Wan's district in Astoria, Queens. As negotiated by the council, the project will be comprised of approximately 45% affordable units, as the applicant and administration have agreed to incorporate the development of HPD-financed affordable housing buildings and CityFEPS vouchers in addition to the requirements of MIH Option 1. The updated project includes significant changes that deliver major housing and community benefits for residents of the area. It doubles the initial commitment of affordable units from 700 to 11 units to one from 711 units to 1,436 affordable units. It increases deeply affordable housing at an unprecedented scale in the neighborhood, providing 825 deeply affordable apartments for extremely or very low income households, dedicates affordable housing units for the formerly unhoused, and sets aside units that were previously market rate for extremely low income people with CityFEPS rental vouchers, and finally, it secures community benefits that include a $2 million commitment towards legal services to protect neighboring tenants from housing displacement, discrimination, and harassment. This project was a major priority for me and this city to get done in the right way, and I'm very proud for how it advanced. Finally, we will vote on the following pieces of legislation. First, Introduction 525B, sponsored by Councilmember Gail Brewer, would require that any secondhand dealer purchasing a used catalytic converter must first obtain information from the seller about the vehicle the catalytic converter was removed from, which demonstrates that the seller either owns the vehicle or was authorized to remove the catalytic converter in connection with a repair. In addition, the purchaser would be required to determine if the catalytic converter presented is consistent with the identified vehicle. The purchaser would be required to hold records of this information for at least 6 years and make them available to law enforcement in real time. Thank you to our staff, Rachel Cordero and Joshua Kingsley. Next, Introduction 610A, sponsored by Councilmember Eric Botcher, would require the Department of Education to distribute information to students annually regarding suicide prevention, including information about the new national 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline number, suicide warning signs and risk factors, and other suicide prevention resources. We thank our staff, Smita Deshmukh, Sarah Liss, Malcolm Buthorn, and Nadia Jean-Francois. Next, Introduction 609A, sponsored by Deputy Speaker Diana Ayala, would require the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene to establish a year-long pilot program to offer financial incentives for the return of used needles, syringes, and sharps at locations in the five council districts with the highest need. The program would only be open to individuals who use needles, syringes, or sharps for non-medical reasons. Lastly, Introduction 404A, sponsored by our Mental Health, Disabilities, and Addiction Committee Chair, Councilmember Linda Lee, would require DOHMH or another agency designated by the mayor to report on funds allocated to the city through the opioid settlement sharing agreement with the state or any agreement with an opioid supply chain participant. The report must be made within 30 days of the release of each city financial plan or update and would disclose the total amount of opioid funds, where the funds are being sent, the number of New Yorkers benefiting from the funds, and anticipated appropriation of the funds broken down by fiscal year. We thank our staff once again, Shmita Deshmukh, Sarah Liss, Sarah Suker, and Christy Dwyer. I also want to say welcome back to Councilmember Julie Menon. Glad to see you in good health. Welcome back, Councilmember. And I would like to greet the mother of our general counsel, Jeffrey Campagna. If she is here today, I'm told that your mom is somewhere, Jeff. So welcome to Jeff's mom today, if she's here. Thank you for your attention. Now I'd like to turn it back into the hands of our majority leader.
Thank you, and welcome to Jeff's mom. He does a great job up here. I just want to let you know that. Thank you, Speaker Adams. We'll now move to discussions of general orders. We're going to start with Councilmember Wan.
Thank you so much, Majority Leader. From day one, I've stood with my community in demanding deeper affordability from Innovation Queens. When developers first certified this project, it was a majority luxury development that offered the minimum 25% affordability on private land. But because we held the line, the Innovation Queens project has now doubled the affordable units from 711 to 1,436 affordable units, as well as doubling the number of family-sized units that are affordable from 284 to 554. In our negotiations, I never compromised on the level of affordability at MIH Option 1, as well as prioritizing low-income units and extremely low-income units for formerly homeless, as these homes have to be accessible to the current residents of my neighborhood, immigrants, working-class families, and our growing number of unhoused neighbors. As a result, we have secured a project with unprecedented private investment that will deliver 1,436 permanent affordable homes, including 658 deeply affordable units for formerly homeless and extremely low-income New Yorkers. And within that, we also have 142 supportive housing units, 157 rental voucher units, specifically for those currently in our shelter system. Right now, my very neighborhood, I have 6,600 homeless people, and we know how important it is during this homeless crisis where we have more than 56,000 homeless New Yorkers to make sure that we are building for them. We will no longer in my district allow luxury development to outpace the development of affordable units. I am proud to have negotiated other immense gains for our community, including $2 million for anti-harassment and anti-displacement legal fund to make sure that those who are in fear of displacement are protected. And we have also made sure that we converted 600 parking spaces to affordable housing, and we also have assistance for current residents and businesses for relocation, multilingual applications for assistance for affordable housing, and much more. So I thank all of our community members for organizing, advocating, as well as our council members for holding the line with me and the speaker and the mayor for allowing us to get to where we are today, because we would not have accomplished what many have said is impossible on private land without all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and congratulations, Councilmember Wan. We'll now go to Councilmember Brewer.
Thank you very much. It's intro 525. The speaker mentioned the catalytic converters, and according to the police and others, the theft of these converters, depending on who you ask, there are other statistics, is up 221% year-to-date, or even 269%, somewhere between almost 5,600 to over 7,000 thefts citywide. In Manhattan, it's up 199%, and in Staten Island, I don't know what's with Staten Island, 670%. So it's not just an economic problem, because it takes just 2 minutes to take out the converter. I've never done it, but 2 minutes is really quickly. The thieves resell the metals found inside the device to chop shops or on the black market. I don't like that term, but that's what it's sometimes called. Replacing the part can run a crime victim anywhere from $2,000 to $3,000 for his or herself. So it's not just an economic problem, because you also have to call your insurance company, you got to find an auto repair shop, and you have to get the converter replaced. And then the other problem, which the speaker's had in her district, I've had in my district, is for whatever reason, the trucks that bring seniors and others food on a regular basis, all these great nonprofit organizations that have worked so hard to get vehicles, guess what? They get their catalytic converter theft experienced often. That means no food delivery for those seniors. And I've heard from many who've had this problem. So this bill will make it harder for thieves to resell stolen converters. It requires sellers of the catalytic converters to provide a vehicle ID number and a copy of the certificate of title. Sellers and buyers who fail to comply will be subject to fines. And in addition, any violation may be grounds for the suspension or revocation of a license for that business. The new requirements will destabilize, we hope, the activities of chop shops. Multiple local police precincts are also ramping up awareness. I've seen their flyers and I appreciate it. And just finally, we know the governor signed legislation which complements this in terms of figuring out how they can do some records and figuring out where they can have some unique serial numbers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilmember Brewer. And I go to Councilmember Barron.
Thank you very much, colleagues. I want to thank you for the support of the Urban Village Project in my community. It's 100% affordable, 60% for the very low, and 40% affordable, as we define affordability for the income levels in our community. However, honesty constrains me to say, and maybe the council member couldn't say it herself, but with Council Member Juan went through, none of you should
please
have
to don't go. Refer to another council member. You can speak about the topic, but don't make things against another council member.
But the council member that spoke before me said that she went through a lot, well, before the council member, before that council member. In any event, the council member on the Queens Project went through a lot. You are going to go through the same thing when you try to reach for affordability. That was only 55% she was talking about. But when it came to the local, the subcommittee, she asked for more time. Because she needed more time. The speaker, no. And she had to go forth, and she didn't even show up to the meeting because she needed more time to negotiate it. But whether y'all like it or not, whether I get in trouble or not, the Queensborough president, pro real estate, the speaker of this body,
please don't make allegations against other council members. You can speak about
all,
the topic,
first of
but that's against,
I didn't
against
mention,
the rules of the city council.
I didn't mention any names. There are pro real estate people in this city. The speaker, the mayor, and the borough president of Queens. She went under a lot of pressure and went from 55% to 45%. And that is below, and they'll tell you when you go for your projects, we pay too much for the land. It won't be economically feasible. This is not an affordable project. We made a record. We usually get 25%, 30%. So I'll be voting no for this project on principle, but y'all beware, you could be next.
We'll now go to Councilmember Lee, followed by Councilmember Hanks.
Okay, good afternoon, Madam Speaker, Majority Leader, and my fellow council members. As Chair of the Committee on Mental Health, Disabilities, and Addictions, it brings me great pride to introduce my first bill, Intro 404, which we'll be voting on today. Across our country, families are experiencing the devastating effects on the ongoing opioid overdose epidemic. In New York, the latest data shows that one New Yorker dies of an opioid overdose every 3 hours. So let that sink in, every 3 hours. With more New Yorkers dying of drug overdoses than homicides, suicides, and motor vehicle crashes combined. Opioids are involved in more than 88% of all overdose deaths, and the manufacturers of these deadly opioids profited at the expenses of families here in New York City. Intro 404 will require DOHMH to track and report on the funds secured for New York City by New York State Attorney General Letitia James from settlements with opioid manufacturers and distributors. Reporting will include a running total of the funds, where and how they are being spent, and a timeline of when this crucial funding for our city will be depleted. While no amount of money could ever bring back those we have lost or repair the damage to lives that were affected, our city deserves clarity and transparency on how this vital funding will be spent so that we can understand the reasons for drug use and misuse, prevent addiction, and create measures that incorporate preventative care and resources. I encourage my colleagues to support Intro 404, and I want to thank my staff, and especially Council Committee staff, specifically Sarah Sucher, Christy Dwyer, and Sarah Liss, my colleagues on the Committee on Mental Health, Disabilities, and Addictions, and the leadership of Speaker Adrian Adams for helping me bring this important legislation to the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we'll hear from Councilmember Hanks.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Adams, Majority Leader Powers. Today I wanted to express my support for the land use item concerning the new 252-seat early childhood center facility proposed by the New York City School Construction Authority. As our populations keep growing and changing, we are seeing an increased need for children of all ages to have a safe, reliable, and high-quality options as they enter the educational system. I look forward to having this land use item pass and ensuring that the children in my district have an advanced, well-rounded space in which to begin their educational journeys for generations to come. Thank you so much, and join me in supporting this item.
Thank you. Do we have any other members signed up to speak at this time? Okay, we'll move to the report of special committees.
None.
Reports of standing committees.
Report of the Committee on Consumer and Worker Protection, Intro 525B, Catalytic Converters.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Education, Intro 610A, Suicide and Crisis Lifeline.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Finance, Intro 789, Business Improvement Districts.
Coupled on general orders.
Preconsidered Reso 388, Transparency Resolution.
Coupled on general orders.
Preconsidered LU 147 and Reso 398, Property Tax Exemption.
Coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Land Use, LU 126 through LU 134 on page 8, Innovation Queens.
Approved with modifications and referred to the City Planning Commission pursuant to Section 197 of the New York City Charter.
LU 135 through LU 138, Livonia 4.
Approved with modifications and referred to the City Planning Commission pursuant to Section 197 of the New York City Charter.
LU 139 and Reso 399 and LU 140 and Reso 400, 1571 McDonald Avenue rezoning.
Coupled to be filed pursuant to letter of withdrawal.
LU 141 and Reso 401 and LU 142 and Reso 402, Innovative Urban Village.
Coupled on general orders.
LUs 143 and 144, 280 Bergen Street rezoning.
Approved with modifications and referred to the City Planning Commission pursuant to Section 197 of the New York City Charter.
LU 145 and Reso 403 and LU 146 and Reso 404, Innovative Urban Village.
Coupled on general orders.
Preconsidered LU 148 and Reso 405, 252-seat Early Childhood Center.
Coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Mental Health, Disabilities, and Addiction, Intro 404A, Opioid Settlement Sharing Agreement.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Intro 609A, Needle Syringe Buyback Program.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
On the general orders calendar, LU 116 and Reso 356A, 7918 164th Street rezoning.
Coupled on general orders.
LU 126 and Reso 406 through LU 134 and Reso 414 on page 16, Innovation Queens rezoning.
Coupled on general orders, I now ask that the clerk take a roll call vote on all of the items coupled on today's general orders calendar.
Abreu.
Permission to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
We are living in a dire housing crisis in this city. We are seeing it everywhere from Queens to uptown Manhattan. And I just want to say that today is a proud vote of an aye. And the reason being is we took a stand for housing and true affordability. We made tough decisions. We came together at the table. We stayed at the table to make sure that we negotiate in good faith to build affordable housing. So I want to thank my colleagues, but I especially want to thank our speaker, Adrian Adams, to think that there have been 40 ULURP applications and over 12,000 units so far this year is a big deal. And we're going to continue this legacy because we're going to be the council that supports affordable housing everywhere in this city. Thank you. I vote aye.
Thank you, Councilmember. Ariola.
Aye on all except for intro 609A, for which I am a no.
Aviles.
Permission to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
First, I'd like to congratulate Councilmember Barron on another 100% affordable project. Given the crisis of the city, we should be absolutely expecting every project that comes through to set aside units for homeless New Yorkers, for extremely low-income New Yorkers. And so while I congratulate the efforts of my colleague Julie Wong in Queens and her heroic efforts, we as a city should never be developing projects below at least 60% affordability, given that it is the number one crisis in New York City. With that, I vote aye on all projects. And while I commend the efforts that are being made, it is still a crisis. And we need to be braver and bolder in building affordable units, in building low-income housing. Excuse me. Thank you. I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Ayala.
I vote aye on all.
Barron.
May I explain my vote?
Go ahead.
First of all, I want to commend the Council Member Wong, since we can mention names now when it's not me mentioning them. I want to commend you for your efforts, and I want to criticize the mayor, I want to criticize the speaker, and I want to criticize the borough president of Queens for putting that kind of pressure on you. Secondly, I want to vote no on the tax exemption for LU 147, Reso 398. It's 244 units, 207 of those units are 95 to 115% of the AMI, and only 37% of those units are at 60% of the AMI. So I want to vote no for that, and no for all of the innovative Queens rezoning LUs and Resos, accompanying Resos. And on the question of Dumbo being the bid getting more money, there was some criticism of it in the finance meeting because they're not transparent, and they haven't put neighborhood residents on the board that are truly neighborhood residents. Some people on the board are real estate neighborhood residents. So I voted yes in finance, but I want to change that to a no vote until they put the right residents on the board, until they engage in transparency. So that's a no vote as well. And I want to, for transparency, say that my son works for BRIC, Brooklyn Media Arts. Aye on all the rest. And I want to commend once again for the 100% affordability with CCC and all of the negotiators, my staff. I'm going to give them credit over the years, and the former council member, Inez Barron, for it started with her and ended 100% affordability with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Just before we call the next vote, I just want to remind members, we do have rules about decorum here in the chamber and how you talk to your colleagues and how you talk about issues and how you talk about things they're working on. I'd ask members to look at those rules again and remind themselves of it before you come to state a meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Osei.
I vote aye on all.
Thank you, Councilmember. Botcher.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
I want to also commend Councilmember Wan on this project that will create homes for thousands and thousands of people who are currently living in the homeless shelter system, and will create lots of housing that will help relieve some of the pressure out there that will help bring down rents in all of our districts. I vote aye.
Thank you. Brannon.
Congrats, Julie. Aye.
Brewer.
I want to thank everyone who have, from the staff and from the speaker's office, who has been working on the catalytic converters. I want to thank one of the bids, 125th Street bid. Barbara Askins does a great job with monumental challenges, and I think this extra funding will help. And then finally, I too want to thank Julie Wan. I know what it's like to do maybe 200 ULURPs when I was borough president, and they're all difficult, but this one was particularly difficult, and you did a great job, along with the speaker staff. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Brooks Powers.
First, I'd like to disclose that I'm a member of the Greater Allegheny Meade Cathedral of New York. We are voting on a transparency resolution for one of our community programs. Next, I'd like to explain my vote. Majority Leader.
Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like to ask everyone to lift up in prayer my community, as we suffered a tremendous loss recently with a triple homicide in the Springfield Gardens community, where we lost Patricia Johnson, Hyacinth Brown Johnson, and Latoya Gordon. This was a very quiet, quaint community block, and I just really ask that we continue to keep the community lifted in prayer during this time. I also want to thank my colleagues for their work on today's slate of bills, including Councilmember Eric Botcher for his work on Intro 610 to ensure students have access to crucial resources in times of crisis. I deeply admire Councilmember Botcher's advocacy on these issues. He's been open and courageous when discussing his own experiences with mental health, and he's a strong advocate for the LGBTQ community. Young people who are a part of the LGBTQ community are more likely to attempt suicide or experience mental health conditions. So I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of this important piece of legislation, which is Intro 610, and I believe we need to do everything we can to help students get the help and support they need. So again, I'm grateful to Councilmember Botcher for his work around this. And with that, I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Caban.
Aye on all.
Carr.
I'd like to disclose on the record that my spouse is a student at CUNY, and we are funding CUNY in this transparency resolution. And with that, I vote no on Intro 609A and aye on the rest. Thank you, and have a happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you. De La Rosa.
I'd like to disclose on the record that my daughter is a student in a New York City public school that is listed on the transparency result today, and I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Dinowitz.
Aye on all.
Farias. Thank you.
I'd like to disclose for the record that my sibling attends a New York City public school, MS 127, and my mother works at NYU Langone for this transparency result. And I vote aye on all. Congrats, Councilmember Wan. It's hard to build on private lands in the way that you did for your community.
Thank you. Felice.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
I vote aye on all, and I want to congratulate Councilmember Julie Wan. The affordable housing crisis and the homeless crisis affecting our city is well documented. We resolve that crisis by building affordable housing, and we cannot allow anyone to make any excuses on the issue. We need to build affordable housing. Congratulations, Councilmember Julian, on that well-negotiated agreement, which includes lots of deep affordable housing. It's a great agreement, not only for your district, but it's a great agreement for the rest of our city. So congratulations, aye on all. Thank you.
Thank you. Gennaro.
Aye.
Gutierrez.
Aye.
Hanif.
Aye. Thank you.
Hanks.
Aye on all.
Holden.
I would like to disclose on the record that my son is an adjunct lecturer at CUNY, and we're voting on the transparency reso today. And I'd like to, on my vote, aye on all except for Intro 609A, of which I vote no. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Hudson.
I'd like to disclose on the record that my domestic partner is employed by Planned Parenthood, which we're funding in the transparency resolution. I'm aye on all, and I also want to add that earlier this year, I approved a project, private land, private developers with an unprecedented 35% deeply affordable housing
Councilmember Wan, you took the bar, you raised it, you ran with it, and I am hopeful that this council will continue to raise the bar and that we will get closer and closer to even higher levels of deeply affordability. Thank you. Aye on all.
Thank you. Councilmember Barron?
Yeah, I just want to change that Dumbo vote because I did get a commitment from the Chair of Finance to send a letter to them to deal with transparency and neighborhood residents on the board. So I changed that no to an aye.
And Councilor Roberts, speaking, introduction 789, the two bids?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. You got it. Councilmember Joseph.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
Congratulations, Councilmember Wan. Also, I'd like to disclose that my son is a student at in the DOE system that we're voting on today. I got a firsthand glimpse at the mental health facing our city's children and how hard the past couple of years has been on them. The isolation and caused by COVID-19 hit us all in real ways, but in particular affected our young people. In the last year alone, more than 11% of New York State's youth had experienced at least one major depressive episode. And of these young people, only 41% of them received mental health services. That means 85,000 students residing in this city didn't receive any help for their mental health needs. As a result of that failure, hundreds of our young people took their own lives. Every single one of these deaths could have been prevented. It is our job as elected leaders to bring suicide as close to zero as we can. The problem is that while there is help available, many are unaware because they have not been informed of that fact. As the chair of the Council on Education Committee, I'm so proud to have passed this bill along with Eric Boucher. Inform students about suicide prevention and warning signs, as well as how to reach 988 National Suicide Prevention Lifeline and other resources. Informing our students about suicides, giving them the help they need, and how we prevent needless death, and how we can improve the future of city mental well-being. This bill is about knowledge, as we all know, knowledge is power. Thanks to Councilmember Eric Boucher for being the driving force behind this bill, as well as my fellow Prime co-sponsor, Linda Lee, for hard work to make this bill pass a reality. And thank you, Speaker. Thanks as well to the mental health providers and advocates who helped get this bill over the finish line. These leaders can be frequently overlooked, but their dedication and commitment is how the work really gets done on the ground. I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Kagan.
I would like to disclose that my daughter is a CUNY student and we are voting today for transparency resolution that includes CUNY funding, and I'm voting yes on all.
Thank you. Krishnan.
I just want to disclose on the record that my son is a child within the DOE system and I vote aye on all. Thank you.
Thank you. Lee.
I would also like to disclose that my child is a student in the DOE system. And I vote aye on all, and congratulations, Councilmember Wan, for a hard-fought battle, and congratulations to my colleagues on all the bills being passed. And I'm excited to pass two bills in particular that will address the mental health and opioid crisis, so thank you.
Lewis.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
Thank you, Majority Leader and Speaker. First, I want to commend all bill sponsors on the vote today. I want to personally commend Councilmember Wan on your efforts to stand with your community. I know this process wasn't easy for you, but I want to commend you for standing with your community. I want to congratulate and thank former Councilmember Inez Barron, Councilmember Barron himself, for your support and leadership on the East New York Innovative Urban Village Project. And I want to thank Senior Pastor A.R. Bernard from CCC for staying the course and for allowing God to lead and ensure this project became the reality that he envisioned. It took 6 years, sleepless nights, much diligence, and many contentious fights and hard work to get to this point where East New York Innovative Village is now a reality, resulting in partnerships, and it equates to shared values that strikes the right balance for the community to receive both affordability and feasibility so that they can continue to thrive. Lastly, I would be remiss if I didn't use this moment to share my disdain regarding a major human rights issue facing Haitian descendants in the Dominican Republic. And if I could get an opportunity later, I'd like to share more. Thank you. I vote aye on all.
Thank you, Councilmember. Marte.
I vote aye.
Mealy.
I vote aye.
Menon.
I vote aye.
Moya.
I vote aye.
Thank you. Narcisse.
Second to explain my vote, please.
Go ahead.
I want to say thank you and congratulate to Council Member Wong for, you know, fighting through this and ask for the support. While we have private lands and city lands, so not every time we're going to have project 100% of what we want, but you show the leadership, and I want to say thank you to you. And Eric, I am so proud of you for Intro 610. It's a needed introduction for the time that we're going through. There's so much mental health and suicide around us. And I want to say thank you to Madam Speaker for being the leader that you are in the time that is very difficult. And there's tests that we under a lot of tests all the time, but for your strength, for standing and pushing us through and helping us and holding our hands to some matter. So I want to say thank you, and let's continue. There is a need, there is a crisis in our city for housing, but being the person that you are, I want to say thank you. And for my colleague, Charles, that's been fighting for East New York, so I want to say thank you for that, and I'm hoping that I have public land, city land on my part so I can have 100% like you. So thank you. Oh, I vote aye, sorry.
Thank you. Nurse. Palladino. Wrestler.
Vote aye on all, and just want to congratulate Council Members Juan and Barron and the Dumbo bid, who do a really great job in our community. So really pleased that we were able to increase their assessment. Thank you.
Thank you. Richardson Jordan.
Permission to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
I just want to say again, and I've said it before, how profoundly undemocratic the land use process is. And while I do think I feel there's something inherently imperialist about weighing in on other people's communities, I do want to just urge my colleagues to work towards community standards with your community in a democratic way and then stick to them as we have done in District 9. I also want to congratulate the 125th Street bid and aye on all. Thank you.
Thank you. Riley.
I just want to disclose for the record that both my daughters are students in the DOE, and I vote aye on all. Thank you.
Thank you. Rivera.
I vote aye.
Thank you. Salamanca. Sanchez.
Permission to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
First, I'd like to disclose on the record that my brother works at Jimmy BMCC. And then I'd also want to extend a deep congratulations to Council Member Juan for a hard-fought negotiation. And I just want to make a statement for progeny, I suppose, but we elected a majority female council, a powerful women. And I just want to make sure that we, in these conversations, and as we congratulate Council Member Juan, we also continue to stand by strong women, not just because we're strong women, but when we are values aligned and we're fighting for things that we believe for and we share beliefs, deeper affordability, a better New York, that we stand by each other. So with that, I vote aye on all, and congratulations to my colleagues.
Thank you. Shulman.
Permission to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
I actually wasn't going to say anything, but I am now. So one, I want to congratulate my colleague, Councilmember Julie Wan, and I want to say, as somebody who was a member of the Zoning and Franchise Subcommittee, got my own pressures in terms of how to vote on this, and every time that I got asked the question, I said, it's up to the member to negotiate this out, and I wasn't going to say anything until that happened, and I was in direct contact with her, which is the way it should be. We should keep in mind this is private property. This isn't city property. She did the best that she could do, and not only that, she got more than probably anybody else would have. So I want to congratulate her, and I also want to say that this, without the speaker's leadership, this wouldn't have happened either. So I wanted to say that, and with that, I say aye on all.
Thank you. Stevens.
Aye on all.
Ung. Velasquez.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
I'd like to disclose my brother is a board member of Samaritans New York. My husband is a deputy commissioner of DEP. With that being said, I want to thank council members Botcher and Joseph for 610A. It is deeply, deeply personal for me and my family, and thank you. Thank you for that. I also want to give a shout out to my girl, Councilmember Juan. It wasn't easy. Trust me, I've been in those shoes very, very, very publicly. And at the end of the day, you did what was right. And you stuck to your guns. And I'm always here to keep on supporting not only yourself, but other council members who are here to actually build within the community and move each other forward. So thank you so much for that. Lastly, I'd like to vote aye on all with the exception of 609A, which I abstain.
Thank you. Councilmember Barron.
Yeah, just for a point of clarification, to my colleague, my project is not city-owned land. It is not city-owned land. It's privately owned. Many of my projects are privately owned. So I think we need to get clear when you say things to make it appear as though unless it's city-owned land, you can't get affordability. We've gotten 100% affordability on privately owned land. This is not city-owned land.
Thank you. Vernikov.
I vote aye on all except no on 609A. Thank you.
Thank you. Williams.
I'd just like to disclose for the record that I'm a CUNY student receiving fellowship support, and I vote aye on all. Congrats, Councilmember Juan.
Thank you. Juan.
Permission to explain my vote?
Go ahead.
I just want to show my extreme thank and gratitude to all of my colleagues and the speaker and the mayor. And, you know, the negotiations, I always knew that it was going to be a compromise, and we got to a level, of course, I want more for my community, and I will continue to fight for more in all of my battles for land use. But I just wanted to say thank you to everyone holding the line with me and just showing so much support today, because it is not easy when your community is disappointed and sad, but we know that we're doing the best that we can in the circumstances that we're in during an affordable housing crisis. Thank you. Sorry, aye on all.
Thank you. Jaeger.
Maybe excuse to explain my vote.
Go ahead.
I'll just be very brief. Thank you very much. As you can imagine, I'll be voting no on introduction 789. I just want to briefly point out one of these bids, the total assessment is going up by 100%. The other one, it is going up by 36%. They are cold bid assessments. They are tax increases. There's no question about it, and we ought to at least say so. So I'm here to say so. I vote aye on all with the exception of introduction 609 and introduction 789. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilmember. Borelli.
Permission to briefly explain my vote.
Briefly permitted.
And thank you, Majority Leader, for reminding us of the rules today. We shouldn't call each other by name, but perhaps Karen would be an appropriate name. I'm kidding with you, Keith. I'm kidding. That was my joke.
Permission taken away.
But what I'm not joking about is something that we've all sort of hinted around, those of us who explained their votes and discussed the rezoning, and that's the concept of member deference. And it's sometimes a dirty word. It's sometimes a word that people like to fight about and argue about whether we should have it or not. I just want to remind everyone in this room that each of you are the only real elected representatives at the municipal level of what would be the 150th largest city in the United States of America. All of you represent about 172,000 people now. And unlike the 149th city and up, you are the only person that represents them on a municipal level. And I always use the comparison with one of my favorite places, Savannah, Georgia. In Savannah, you elect a mayor, two council members at large, a district council member, and a legislator for Chatham County. All of those people represent the people of the city of Savannah, smaller than your district, and you are expected to have the power of all of those people. So whether you like it or not, and whether your constituents like it or not, you're their only voice. So don't be quick to cast aside the idea that we should be supportive of our colleagues, no matter what their vision, no matter what their goals. They should be the one, in my opinion, who should have the final say on what gets built in what would be the 150th largest city in America. With that, I vote aye on all except intro 609. Thank you.
Thank you. Powers.
Thank you, Councilmember Riley. Always a lightning when you get up and share your thoughts with us. I'm voting aye. I want to say a very big congratulations to Councilmember Juan for staying at the table and driving a very, very, very good deal for not only constituents in Queens, but also for people citywide and people that don't even live here yet who are going to have the opportunity to live in a great neighborhood and live in a great place to live. So I think it really shows a lot of strength there to be able to cut a deal that I think will be transformative, and I think on its own represents almost more housing than we will have approved this year before now. So I think we have now doubled that. And I, of course, want to thank the speaker and all the staff for support on this quest to try to create a more affordable city and create not only the housing supply we need, but also to empower members to get to the table and stay there and like Councilmember Juan has shown, drive a deal that will be generous to everyone that is here and everyone that is coming next, and to create a city that we all deserve. So with that, I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Speaker Adams.
I vote aye.
All items on today's general order calendar adopted by a vote of 47 in the affirmative, 0 negative, and 0 abstentions, with the exception of introduction 609A, which is adopted by a vote of 40 in the affirmative, 6 in the negative, and 1 abstention, and land use item 147 and resolution 398, adopted by a vote of 46 in the affirmative, 1 negative, and 0 abstentions. Land use items 126 through 134 and accompanying resolutions adopted by a vote of 46 in the affirmative, 1 negative, and 0 abstentions, and introduction 789 adopted by a vote of 46 in the affirmative, 1 negative, and 0 abstentions. We'll now move to the introduction and reading of bills.
All bills have been referred to committees as indicated on today's agenda.
Thank you. There are no resolutions on today's calendar, so we'll move into general discussion. And we will first call on Councilmember Gennaro, followed by Councilmember Barron.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. I just want to point out to my colleagues that today is the 59th anniversary of the assassination of John F. Kennedy. He doesn't get a lot of attention these days, but he should certainly be remembered. And very hard to paint a picture of those who don't remember that day. It was a day of sorrow that I can't describe. Gail is raising her hand saying that she remembers, and I'm sure some people remember. But we were let out of school early that day. You know, Catholic school, the nuns were going nuts. It was a very sad, tragic day. And I always depended upon my dad, you know, World War II vet, who could abide any situation and make everything right, make everything feel okay. And I walked into the house, and he closed his business early. He was kneeling in front of the television set, crying his eyes out, saying the rosary, like with the rosary beads in his hand. He was completely destroyed, and I knew that my rock would, you know, if something could get to him, then the world was never going to be the same again. And it's a poignant day. I could go on, but, like, the grief cannot be imagined what it did to the country, and I just think it's fitting to remember him, and there you have it.
Thank you. We're going to go to Councilmember Barron. And before we do that, I was asked by Councilmember Riley to inform members of the BLAC to stay here in the chamber afterwards to take a picture.
Thank you once again to my colleagues. We are the only conscious. We are the only power that the people really have. And the reason why I constantly tell you to use your power on behalf of the people, not a speaker, not a mayor, not a borough president. Speaker has one vote, mayor has none, and the borough president has none. You have 50 votes. And if you would have said for the council member, look, we're going to go with you on your definition of affordability for your community, and at 55%, they would have told you that we won't do it if you stay there. And they would have come back to the table like so many of them have. One or two may go away and never come back, and they'll try to blame that on you, that you're anti-development. But I just want to encourage you to allow yourselves to be strong. The councilwoman has to go against a large segment of her community to get this done, and that didn't have to be. That did not have to be. If you would have stood strong with her when she was at 55%, and no matter what they said, I've seen it in my 20 years, they told me it's not economically feasible. We pay too much for the land. If we do that affordability, then we're going to have to raise the rents. All of that stuff. And when I said, no, go ahead, they come back to the table. And to my colleague, do your research before you start saying stuff. A lot of my projects are not city-owned land. It's privately owned and city-owned. But when we stay together as a council, you are the power. You are the power around anything, a budget, any legislation, all of the development stuff that comes in. The people in this city are counting on you because you have the power, and you should exercise it on behalf of the people, not on your personal interest.
We're going to go now to Councilmember Jordan, followed by Councilmember Caban.
Hi, everyone. So again, I want to congratulate Councilman Barron on his project, but I also would like to congratulate all the housing advocates and activists who won a significant victory last week in pushing the mayor to expand much-needed rental assistance. We cannot continue to call the current housing situation a crisis while using a status quo approach. This is what got us here in the first place. This is why we must do more, and I am introducing a bill that would push city departments towards using housing first strategies. As our city continues to manage the influx of migrants who deserve compassion and care, and also Black unhoused who have been here for generations who also deserve compassion and care, we must move beyond the shelter system. My bill would amend the duties of the Department of Homeless Services Commissioner to emphasize permanent housing. It would clarify DHS housing readiness training and require the commissioner to give an annual report on such and post it online. It would also require the commissioner to make DHS permanent housing clearinghouse available to each transitional housing facility, who would create a plan to utilize the clearinghouse to help move folks into permanent housing. Lastly, it would update the five-year plan to relieve homelessness and require the commissioner to post the plan on the DHS website. We know from experts that prioritizing permanent housing leads to an increased sense of agency, stability, and participation in support services. It can also save this city millions by avoiding expensive emergency service costs. This bill would be crucial in removing barriers and starting needed coordination between departments to plan methods to house all of the unhoused in the city. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go to Councilmember Caban, followed by Councilmember Ferris.
Yes, I'll be super brief. I'm proud to be introducing two resolutions today that are really dear to me. The first calls for the end to the LUMA energy contract in Puerto Rico and immediately transitioning to a new public corporation based on democratic governance principles. Privatization has failed at reducing costs, improving service, or depoliticizing the electrical system, which is essential to the well-being of the island, and it's time for the power to be in the hands of the people. And so I want to thank some of my fellow Boricua council members for their partnership, council members Aviles, Rivera, Farias, Velasquez, Deputy Speaker Ayala, council member Stevens, and then also ask y'all, I am preparing a letter to send directly to the governor of Puerto Rico and would love to have y'all sign on that. I know most of you have. And then the second is a resolution that Councilmember Nurse and I are introducing in partnership with the dedicated advocates of the campaign to release aging people in prison, also known as RAP. And it calls for Governor Hochul to use her clemency powers frequently, inclusively, and transparently, as well as to pass the state bills for fair and timely parole and elder parole. And I would encourage my peers to visit NewYorkersForClemency.com and to get to know some of the faces of clemency. And just a quick thank you to policy analysts Chad Benjamin and Regina Paul for drafting those resos. Thanks.
Thank you. We'll go to Councilmember Farias, followed by Councilmember Gutierrez.
Thank you, Majority Leader. I'm introducing a bill today, Intro 821, which is very personal to my district and many residents of the Bronx. In May of this year, my district had several positive cases of Legionnaires, as did many other districts across the Bronx, where we even had some fatalities. I've spoken about this before, but I'm excited to be introducing this bill as it is urgent and necessary as we see the water quality issues continue to exist in throughout our city and in our boroughs. With this bill, we have an opportunity to be proactive and establish real protocols that mitigate risk. This is a complex issue that could be solved with a simple, cost-effective solution that's listed in my bill. And I'm encouraging and asking all of my colleagues to put your communities first and to sign on to Intro 821. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Gutierrez, followed by Councilmember Lewis.
Thank you, Majority Leader. Today I'm introducing two bills to add to the package of bills introduced by my colleagues and the increasingly serious conversation around the proliferation of e-bikes across New York City. E-bikes are a key tool of a workforce that is essential to our city's economy, and our delivery workers need and deserve the same safety protections as anyone else in a dangerous job. After the oversight hearing a few weeks ago with the Committee on Fire and Emergency, the two bills I'm introducing today look towards how we can create a new safe career path that contributes to the economy and enables New Yorkers to provide for their families. Intro 892 would establish a battery safety certification for e-bike battery mechanics. This would not only establish standards that could improve the safety of batteries and prolong their usage, which helps workers, it would also create a pathway for new careers. There are already hundreds of deliveristas who are doing this mechanical work, and as a council, we should be supporting and standardizing it so that it becomes a safe and viable career option. I'm also introducing a resolution calling on the U.S. Consumer Product Safety Commission to establish rules and regulations for the safe sale and use of e-bike batteries. As a city and state, we will continue to do what we can to regulate this market, but as long as there are unsafe batteries flowing into the country unregulated, we are facing an uphill battle. There have been close to 200 e-bike battery fires in New York alone in the past 2 years, including children, and it's time the federal government steps in to regulate these products. I also want to wish my daughter a happy early birthday. She's turning 1 year old on Sunday. That's right. I finally finished being pregnant last year.
Thank you. I'm going to go to Councilmember Lewis, followed by Councilmember Ressler, and finally Councilmember Brewer.
Thank you, Majority Leader. As I shared earlier, I wanted to share my disdain regarding a major human rights issue facing Haitian descendants in the Dominican Republic. The Haitian diaspora around the world are troubled with news regarding the expulsion of Haitians in the Dominican Republic to Haiti, and we're calling on the Dominican Republic to cease forced deportations of Haitian migrants and people of Haitian ancestry amid a growing human rights crisis in Haiti, and I'm sure all of you have seen that in the news. So I'm also asking this council to stand with Haitians and Haiti as we do for every other racial and social justice issue in this city, every human rights issue in this city. We're asking for you to also stand with us and not to forget that Haitians are descendants of Africa and that these are the same people that helped to build this nation. So we hope to get the support of this council. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Go to Councilmember Ressler and Councilmember Brewer.
Thank you, Majority Leader. There are 500,000 dogs in New York City.
500,000 dogs, but only 84 dog runs in New York City parks. That is one dog run for every 6,000 dogs. 21 council districts have zero dog runs in your parks. And 12 council districts have just one dog run in their local parks. That means that in two-thirds of the council districts in New York City, there is one or zero dog runs in your local parks. That doesn't make any sense. And you want to know what's even worse? Dog runs are the one portion in a park that the Parks Department doesn't take any responsibility for. They think it's up to all of us, up to neighbors, to clean, to maintain, to improve the conditions in our dog runs. The conditions are totally unacceptable. They are deplorable. There is no drainage in most of the dog runs, and our dogs are living in filth. We all love our dogs. They bring joy. They deserve a decent place to run around and exercise and socialize. So we've introduced two pieces of legislation today, and I hope you'll all co-sponsor them. One, for the Parks Department to identify five viable dog runs in every community district in New York City. And two, for the Parks Department to take responsibility for maintaining our dog runs. This is common sense, basic stuff that we should have done a long time ago, but together, this council, we can look out for our dogs. I know Speaker Adam cares about her dog more than anyone. She really does. So let's make it happen. Thank you all.
Thank you for your vigor on the issue, Councilmember Ressler. We'll go to Councilmember Brewer.
My dog runs have drainage. I just want to let you know. Okay, we have drainage. A few things. Number one, I want to thank Councilmember Gutierrez and everyone who's working on this issue of the batteries. It is complicated. We have other bills that we've introduced, but this one would basically, 819, say that there should be safety guides wherever there is batteries sold. On the other hand, we have to do a lot about the batteries. Number two, Richard Murphy was a youth commissioner under Mayor Dinkins. He has passed, but he always said every young person in the public school should get a water bottle, and there should be water filling stations everywhere. It's hard to tell people not to have sugar drinks if it's hard to find the water. So this would start the discussion with every fire station, police station, and so on, should have a publicly accessible water bottle filling area. And then we'll work on getting it in more places and every young person getting them a water bottle. I also want to just say we're all very supportive, at least I am, of Temporary Schedule Change Act, but we need to do some consumer and worker outreach, and that's Intro 18. And then I appreciate very much the upcoming helicopter oversight hearing. This bill, Resolution 389, would just talk about we've got to get rid of the Hudson River Park Trust heliport. This would say don't have any helicopters flying out of it. We've been trying on every level. What we really need is the federal government to come forward and say, no helicopter, non-essential, over any city of over 8 million. That's us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we have one more. We have Councilmember Yeager.
I'll be very brief. I'm rising to object to the use of the term common sense to describe, as the gentleman used to describe those bills. That's it for me. Thank you.
Oversight.
Objection overruled.
Apparently.
Well, now, I'll call Speaker Agent Adams to close out today's meeting.
I was remiss in disclosing that I, too, am a member of the Greater Allen AME Cathedral, and they are in our transparency resolution today. I also want to just say to this body, number one, how amazing you all are. And in addition to that, decorum should always be upheld in these chambers. And repeating unvalidated hearsay is egregious at best. We can and should do better. Happy Thanksgiving to you all. The stated meeting of November 22, 2022 is hereby adjourned.